Let's stand together. We have raised our hopes and our cities high. We have followed fragile dreams. Only one could take the measure of our goal. And we stumbled over the trials of life. And we've wrestled the unseen. Only one can calm the storm inside our soul. And in the hands of God, we will fall. Rest for the restless and the weary, hope for the sinner. In the hands of God, we stand tall, hands that are mighty to deliver, giving us freedom. When our strength gave way to the weight of guilt, till we strained for every breath, and only one could lift our shame and make us well. All is finished and we face the fearsome power of death. And only one overcome the gates of hell. And in the hands of God, we will fall. Rest for the restless and the weary, hope for the sinner. In the hands of God, we stand tall, hands that are mighty to deliver, giving us freedom. And you're amazing, you are, you're amazing, you're amazing, you are. And we praise you, Lord, for what your hands have done. You're amazing, you're amazing, you are. In the hands of God, we will fall. It's for the restless and the weary, hope for the sinner. And in the hands of God, we will stand.
There you go.
Hands that are mighty to deliver, giving us freedom.
He's amazing.
And you're amazing. You're amazing. You are. You're amazing. You're amazing, you are, and we praise you, Lord, for what your hands have done. You're amazing, you're amazing, you are. And in the hands of God, in the hands of God, in the hands of God, in the hands of God.
Thanks for reminding me. And you know that part where it says, in the hands of God we fall?
Yes.
Because sometimes that's all we can do, man, is just fall there and wait on His mercy and His grace. Thank you, brother. So while we were on break, a Facebook friend of mine logged in from India. So it's nice to have you. Abba, hi to the family, and thank you for joining us. Okay, I get to run my own clicks this morning, but I have a technical problem, so I'm hoping it will resolve itself. In the meantime, I'll just tell you a really cool joke, and that little thing that I'm supposed to log in, Michael, it's not there. that little icon. And I don't know why. I don't know what to do. So I'm going to, I don't know what to do. So I'll tell you the joke in the meantime. Anti-Semite sitting in a bar, looks over to his right, and sees a Jewish guy. And he says, what can I do? Bartender, around for the house of your best booze, except for the Jew. And the bartender serves it up, and the Jew looks over to him, nods and smiles, and goes back to his drink. Now he's really upset because he thought he'd offend him and hurt his feelings. He said, dang it. So he waits a few minutes, and you can see he's just seething. He's fuming. He says, bartender, another round of the best stuff you've got and an appetizer for everybody but the Jew. And the Jew raises his glass and smiles. And he says, what is wrong with that stinking Jew? He says, you mean the guy down there at the end? Yeah. Well, he owns the place. Loving it, loving it, loving it. So I'm out of jokes, and I'm waiting for Michael to come down and fix the... I'm trying to take the week off, but I got a news report. Hey, brother, come do your magic. I got a news report. I put it on Facebook. So if you're a Facebook friend of mine, then you saw this. But it so thrilled me and so inspired me, I want to do a lesson on it. So I'm going to take a break from Revelation for 1 week, and that'll be either next week or the following. And here's what the news report was. A cleric from Jordan is requesting the Palestinian Authority, the Jordanian government, to approve of a house of worship for the Jewish people on the Temple Mount. You may not get the significance of that, and you will after I give you a lesson of it, but that's probably the most exciting thing that's happened on the prophetic calendar since the founding of the nation of Israel back in 48. It's just stunning. And so I'm going to take a lesson and talk to you about it in the near future. So a priest, a rabbi, and a pastor are in a boat having lunch. And the priest runs out of mayo. So he says, you know what? I left some back at the campsite. So he gets out of the boat. He walks across the water, gets some mayo, and comes back and has a sandwich. Pastor's not paying any attention at all. And the rabbi's like, because he's heard the stories about Jesus walking on water. He always thought it was a myth. And he's wondering, wow, what just happened? And the pastor says, man, I forgot the pickles. He gets out of the boat. He walks across the water to the campsite, walks back. And now the rabbi's really annoyed. Well, I forgot my bait. And he steps out of the boat and he immediately stinks and he starts drowning and they grab him and pull him into the boat. And the priest says, did you miss that first stone? They're getting worse because this ain't getting any better. I don't know what to do. I'm just so lost. I guess I'm just going to have to give you a sermon without slides. Oh, Michael's back. I'll do the sermon without slides if I have to. It's all good. By the way, Pastor Michael, everybody, huh? Thank you. I don't know where I would be without that brother, honestly. He is always coming to my rescue for one thing or another. All right, so we've been looking at the seven churches in the book of Revelation. And we're looking at the church today, the church of brotherly love, the church in Philadelphia. We're in Revelation chapter 3, verses 7 through 9, and here's what we've got. To the angel of the congregation or church in Philadelphia write, these are the words of him who is holy and true, who holds the key of David. What he opens, no one can shut. And what he shuts, no one can open. I know your deeds. See, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know that you have a little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. I will make those who are of the synagogue of Satan who claim to be Jews, though they're not, but are liars, I'll make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you. Now, there's three more verses to this letter to the Philadelphians. Next lesson, we'll look at the next three verses. Hopefully, I'll be able to get through all three of these this morning. So there's seven letters written to seven churches, and there's a seven-point outline to each of the churches. Each one starts off by saying, this letter is addressed to the angel of such and such a community. And as I told you before, that word angel, I think, would be better translated as representative or even ambassador. It's not a unique Greek word that makes us think of a heavenly being. It just means messenger. So to the representative of the church in Philadelphia. And then the second point is the cities mentioned by name. Then part of the Messiah's character is revealed based on the revelation of him in the first couple of chapters. After that, the congregation's good deeds are mentioned, the bad deeds are mentioned, a warning is given, and a promise is given. And the exception to this is some of the congregations don't have any good deeds to mention, and some of the congregations don't have any bad deeds to mention. Philadelphia is one of the few churches, one of two, that nothing bad is said about them. Then a piece of Messiah's character is revealed, and here's that piece. These are the words of him who is holy and true. So Jesus is revealed as both holy and true. Holy means fully consecrated to God. The more holy you are, the more God's you are. The more God-like, the more God-close. Jesus is 100% holy because he's totally close to God. He's fully consecrated to God. There is nothing about him that was not God-oriented. So he is 100% holy. Now that's our goal. But we often are finding ourselves falling short. And so we strive. And thankfully, Jesus has mercy and grace. He died for our sins and we're good. But we should always live like 100% striving to please God. That's what holy means. What about true? True is not something we call people. Heck, we don't even call people holy. But true, I might say, hey, he's an honest guy. Or he's an upright guy or truthful guy. But I won't say, oh, yeah, he's true. We don't use that language today. So I thought I might have to give you an idea as to what it means. One definition, and there's many, is simply trustworthy. A person who is completely reliable, authentic, and honest. This is what the word means. And that's why one English word doesn't really give us, we don't really know what true means. We need to throw in a bunch of English words. Honest, reliable, trustworthy, authentic. And I guess we use it that way, a true copy of something or an original, true, okay, we can use it that way. Thayer's Greek definitions uses it or defines it this way. That which has the real nature corresponding to the name in every respect, real, true, genuine. And then Thayer's Greek, which is one of my favorite lexicons, does something that you usually don't see. You usually see it off to the side. It gives us the definition by giving us the opposites. Yeah, a thesaurus will give you the opposites, but this is giving us the opposites in the definition. Somehow they think this is the best way to help us understand what this word true means. Opposite to that which is fictitious. Opposite to that which is counterfeit or imaginary. Opposite to that which is simulated or pretended. Opposite to what is imperfect, defective, frail, or uncertain. So when he who is holy and true is revealed, he's the opposite of uncertain. He's the opposite of frail. He's the opposite of defective. He's the opposite of imperfect. He's the opposite of imaginary. He's the opposite of counterfeit. He's the opposite of fictitious. Jesus reveals himself as that to the church in Philadelphia. So we're in the seven-point outline. We know it's to the representative in Philadelphia, and his character is revealed as the one who is holy and true. Then it says, he holds the key of David, and what he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. And the key of David, that's an expression only used a couple times in the Bible. And so most people aren't really familiar with it. So we're going to take a little look at it. Basically, what it means is he has the authority to rule on David's throne. It's saying he is the genuine heir or descendant of King David, and he has the right to rule Israel. That's what it means. The first time this expression occurs is way back in Isaiah. But before I go there, I want to go to something you probably just heard last week. Because every Christmas, at least in the Hallelujah chorus, if not in a sermon or in a radio song somewhere, this passage of Scripture is mentioned. It's one of the most common quoted passages in the Christmas season. And it represents this promise. Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will rest upon his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign over David's throne and over his kingdom forever and ever. By the way, that passage says his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor. You notice there's no comma there. Let me go back here. Some Bibles translate it with a comma, some translate it without. Is he a wonderful counselor, or is he wonderful and a counselor? Not that it matters. It's totally academic, because both are true. But I think it's wonderful, comma, counselor. And I think that for a couple of reasons. First of all, when I look at it in the Hebrew, there's this device in Hebrew, we'll just call it like a hyphenation or a dash. When you see that in Hebrew, it means the two words are closely related. And you see that throughout the Bible when they want to make sure you understand the two words are closely related. It's not there. That dash occurs all around there, but not there. So I think the comma belongs there. Secondly, that word for wonderful is pele. If I'm not mistaken, you go back to where Jacob was wrestling with the angel of the Lord, and he says, why are you asking after my name, seeing it is wonderful? Pele. Same word. So I know he's called Wonderful. And he's also the counselor. And then in that passage, he's called the Prince of Peace, Sar Shalom. That's why our Saturday congregation is called Congregation Beth Sar Shalom. Beth means house or place of worship. Sar Shalom, it's the house of the Prince of Peace. In fact, we had an Israeli visitor with us at our Hanukkah party. We had a few, a couple at least. And the lady's looking at our brochure, first time at our congregation, and she says, Sar Shalom, what does Sar mean? She's an Israeli. She speaks fluent Hebrew. But apparently that word Sar isn't commonly used in modern Hebrew like it was in ancient Hebrew. And it's the same with us. You can pick up a King James Bible and say, what? Or how many of you have ever tried to read Chaucer? The Cliff Notes are easy. Try to read the original. You can't even read the letters. And it's our language from just a couple hundred years ago. So it didn't surprise me that she didn't know what Sar meant. And I said, Sar, it's a prince. 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 Like she didn't know what prince was. Okay, she's learning English. And I said, Ben Melech, son of the king. Ah, Ben Melech. And she said, ah, in the Knesset, the leaders over different departments, what we might call a minister or a secretary, they call a sar, a leader over a portion of the government. I said, it's very similar. He's the sar over the whole government. I said, that would be one way you could understand it. She said, ah, this is a very interesting congregation. I've never seen anything like it before. I said, yeah, I understand. I get that a lot. And he will reign over David's throne and over his kingdom. So in the Christmas story, that messianic prophecy is always read or sung. It talks about how the Messiah is going to reign over David's throne. Only a descendant of David could do that. So when it says he has the key of David, it's telling us he's the legitimate heir to the Davidic throne. This same promise that's in Revelation, or established in Revelation, promised in Isaiah 9, is confirmed in the Christmas story. Luke chapter 1, verse 26. In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, to a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, descendant of David. It's a reason it says that. And the virgin's name was Miriam, or Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you." All right, let's stop right there for a second. Put yourself in Mary's shoes. What's she doing 5 minutes before this? 5 seconds before this? Praying? Kneading dough? Lighting a candle? Life is just normal. She's never met an angel before, like you and I. She knows they exist. Never met one. All of a sudden, does she turn around and he's standing there all aglow? Does he descend through the ceiling? Does he pop up from the floor? Does he tap her on the shoulder? Either way, she's going to freak out. Angels are magnificent beings that radiate light and holiness and God's energy. And throughout Scripture, almost every time an angel appears, if the person doesn't faint, the angel always says, "Don't be afraid." Angels are scary. They represent God and His glory, and they are scary. Scary in a good sense, which, by the way, is an experience you've probably never had, myself included. But anyway, what's he say to her? Hi! That's what he says. Greetings, hi! In our language. What else is he going to say? And then he says this. Don't be afraid. I told you. You have found favor with God. Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. How cool would that be? That God sends you a message saying that you're highly favored by God. You're one of my specials. You're one of my favorite children. I love you. And boy, have I got a surprise for you. Out of all the women in human history, you get to be Messiah's mom. What do you do with information like that? Well, she composed a nice poem. She wrote a song about it. Stunning, overwhelming, amazing. Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Don't be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be with child and give birth to a son, and you're to give him the name Jesus." And here's what the angel says about Jesus. He will be great. He'll be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father, David. Oh, I thought his father's name was Joseph. He's talking about his ancestor. That word father could just as well be translated ancestor. He will be given the throne of his ancestor, David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end. Amen. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. So the key of David refers to Jesus' Davidic authority, the right to rule over Israel because he's a descendant of King David and the Messiah. And then it says, what he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. What does that mean? Well, just common sense would give us, I think, most of the understanding of it. There's a door, and he's got his hand on the handle, and he's the Almighty God. If he didn't want that door open, it can't open. Now, if he pushes it open, go ahead and try to shut it. So it's talking about his authority again. It's talking about his power, and it's talking about his will. Let me give you the process of how I came up with that. This expression is used only one other time in Scripture, as I mentioned earlier, in Isaiah chapter 22. Now, the last thing I want to do is plug you right in the middle of a prophet without giving you some background. So let me tell you what's going on in Isaiah chapter 22. I'm just going to read the notes of Dr. Rick Wodge on this. Assyria had invaded Judah, but the Jewish leaders were trusting Egypt, not God, to deliver them. One of the treacherous leaders in Israel was a guy named Shebna, who held the key or authority over the house of David. He had used his office not for the good of the people, but for his own private gain. God saw to it that this man was removed from office, and that a faithful man was put in his place and given the keys of authority. That leads us to the quote, and it says, "I will depose you, Shebna, from your office, and you will be ousted from your position. In that day, I will summon my servant Eliakim, son of Hilkiah, and I will place on his shoulder the key to the house of David. What he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. I will drive him like a peg into a firm place. He will be a seat of honor for the house of his father." Okay, so this expression of the key of David and an open and shut door, they go together. They go together in Isaiah, and they go together in Revelation. But those are the only places. And even though the expression is used here in Isaiah, it's not explained. And the context doesn't help us understand it. So we either have to do one of three things. Guess, which I don't recommend ever with God's word. But it's better than the alternative, making something up and thinking it's true. Isn't that guessing? Yeah, but you're adding the thinking it's true part, and that makes it worse. Or look somewhere else. Is there any other place in Scripture this occurs? Well, the keys to David, no. But the opening and the shutting, that occurs in several passages of Scripture. Looking at those gives us an understanding of what it means. And there's at least three more occurrences, and they're all in the New Testament, which again is still a Jewish book. And when we look at those, we begin to learn that an open door means God is paving the way for a fruitful ministry. An open door means this is what God wants to happen, and it will. And a shut door means just the opposite. An example of a shut door in Scripture is one of the apostles, I don't remember, wanted to go somewhere, and God said, "No, you're not going there, go somewhere else." He shut the door to that country for that time and told them to go somewhere else. Another example of a shut door: you want to move to Anchorage. You got a job offer. You pack your bags, and then you get a phone call. "Sorry, the job's no longer yours." Now, you get upset, but God shut the door. He didn't want you in Anchorage. So as upset as you are that you don't get the job, try to remember God didn't want you there, and he knows better. He knows best. It wouldn't have worked out. It would have been painful and miserable, and it just wasn't his plan for you. That's a shut door. Open door means the way to ministry is paved. Here's an example, Acts 14:27. "On arriving there, they gathered the congregation together and reported all that God had done through them and how he had opened the door of faith to the Gentiles." And if you read the story in Acts, Gentiles were just coming to the faith by the hundreds, by the thousands. The church was exploding in growth because God had opened the door. Here's another example, Colossians 4:3. "Pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message so that we may proclaim the mystery of Messiah." Another time, another place, asking for the same open door. And again, 1 Corinthians, "Because a great door for effective work has opened to me, and there are many who oppose me." So, Jesus reveals himself to the Philadelphians as the Holy One, the True One, the door opener, and the door closer. He's the one that paves the way for work and ministry and his will, and he's the one that shuts it down at the same time. Now, a note. You would think that if God is opening the door, everything's going to work out just fine. No. Almost every open door in Scripture that I can think of, every open door I can think of, I'm sure there's some I hadn't thought of, but every open door I can think of is accompanied by hassles, persecution, trials, and tribulations. Think about the greatest open door in human history for the Jewish people to leave Egypt and how God made it happen. But look at what happened. First, they were just done with Moses. They were so fed up because they were being abused even worse after Moses arrived on the scene. And then there were all these plagues, and initially the plagues afflicted everybody, Egyptians and Jews, and then God made a distinction and just put them on the Egyptians. It was a nightmare. How about an open door for salvation? Good for us, not so good for Jesus. Good for us, not so good for his apostles, who are all martyred. The open door, but how many times was Paul abused, stoned, shipwrecked, starved. Oh, he had open doors left and right. But they came with a price tag. My guess is, never good to guess, as long as I don't think it's God's word, I'm okay. My guess is, though, when God ramps it up, Satan ramps it up. When God opens a door, when God greases the gears, Satan's going to try to throw sand into them. Now, Satan always fails, but he does succeed in making it more uncomfortable. But hey, God's work is often done in the furnace, not the air conditioning. And the important thing is that it gets done, not how comfortable it is that it gets done. This is exactly what happened to our Philadelphia church. I'll make those who are of the synagogue of Satan, Revelation 3, verse 9, who claim to be Jews, though they're not, but are liars, I will make them come and fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you. Well, what's that have to do with anything? Synagogue of Satan only occurs twice in the Bible. Both times it's in the book of Revelation. And here's the interesting part. Both times it's in the context of a church where God says nothing wrong with it. There's only two of the seven that aren't condemned, Philadelphia and Smyrna. And in both of those churches, those chapters, that's where the synagogue Satan rears its ugly head. Doors open, godly people, and Satan's thrown in his grit, making their lives miserable. In fact, with the Smyrnans, God said, some of you are even going to die. You're going to be persecuted for 10 days. Some of you will be thrown into prison, and some of you will die. But don't worry about it. We got bigger fish to fry. Death, don't worry about that. I mean, if you think about it, nobody wants to die. But then again, if you love Jesus, what is death but a homecoming? Amen. We get to see our Savior. It's that process of how we die that we might not appreciate so much. Nobody likes to have lung cancer and have a hard time breathing for a few months. Nobody likes to be tortured. I understand that. But dying, that's okay. And I tell God, you know, as soon as you're done with me, I'm ready. I know I'm young, but hey, there's plenty of buses out there. I can get hit by any one of them. And I'm okay with that. I just tell God, but if you still need me here, if my children are better off with me being here, church is better off with me being here, I'm willing to stay. But if they're not, get me out of here. And honestly, I don't know. You think, oh, kids are always better off with their parents. No, that's not always true. It's not always true. And there may be a better pastor out there for you. I know it's hard to believe. So I'm just telling God, hey, as soon as you're ready, take me. I'm good with that. Because, you know, this world, it ain't my home. I am homesick. I long for a place where I will never be sad. I long for a place where I won't have to take ibuprofen and Tylenol anymore. I long for a place where there's no Ebola. I long for a place where Christian children aren't martyred. You know, this is not a good place. Yet God gives us joy and pleasure. Don't get me wrong. I love you people. I enjoy your company. I enjoy your fellowship. Really, it's the thing about life that makes life worth living. My family and my friends. And chocolate cake. No worky? All right, how do I fix that? Do I gotta flick any switches, Michael? I got this really cool video. Does this guy look familiar to anybody? This is Steve Green. I probably had more of his CDs in the 80s and 90s than anybody else's. He's a classically trained singer, which I love, but the lyrics to his songs will just, they'll just take you up to the throne of God, and they'll encourage you. And he wrote a song that to this very day when I listen to it gives me goosebumps. And it's about he who holds the keys of your life. And he's not really just talking about the key of David, though that fits in there too. He's talking about the keys of your existence. But unfortunately, you don't get to hear the song because we are having technical difficulties this morning. So So I'm going to go back and start it over again and see if it works. But I tell you what, if it doesn't work now, I'll close you. We'll have Jose come up and lead us in worship, and then we'll let Michael do his magic again. And I'm sure he can get it to work. And while we're getting ready to dismiss to lunch, we can listen to this song. And I will think it'll give many of you goosebumps. It did me. All right, I'm going to try it one more time. And if it doesn't work, it doesn't work. I can hear it here. So you just sit there and wait for me, okay? Jose, would you come on up? I think we got some grit in the wheels this morning, but it's all good. Better than good. I like that. I took my son Nathaniel, who's now like, I don't know, 22 years old or something. He was probably 2 or 4 at the time. I don't remember. To a Steve Green concert. It was actually with El Camino Baptist Church. We got a bus. We went up to Phoenix. And this was Nathaniel's favorite song at that time. And we crank it up in the car. Yeah, I'm that guy. You don't hear the bass thumping in my car. You hear opera. Roll down the windows. Take that.
I heard him yesterday, and I was hoping to hear him again this morning. But shall we stand together? Heart will sing to you because of your great love. A love so rich, so pure, a love beyond compare. The wilderness, the barren, come a blessing in the warmth of your embrace. When earthly wisdom dims the light of knowing you, or if my search for understanding clouds your way, I'll fly my hiding place, where revelation is beholding face to face. May my heart sing your praise. May my heart sing your praise forever. Lift your name. May my voice lift your name, my God. May my soul know no other treasure than your love, than your love. Let's try that part again. May my heart sing your praise forever. May my voice lift your name, my God. May my soul know no other treasure than your love.
human power, but by your Spirit, oh Lord. And healer of hearts, binder of wounds, and lives that are lost, and flow through this land until every man praises your name once more.
Not by might.
No, not by might, nor even power, but by your Spirit. Oh Lord, and healer of heart, binder of wounds, and lives that are lost, restore and flow through Tucson till every man praises your name once more. You're everywhere and every place and every time and every space and every breath that I take you lend. You're the only one who satisfies, only one that makes my life make sense. You're everywhere, in every place, in every time, in every space, and every breath that I take you in. You're the only one who satisfies, only one that makes my life make sense. You're everywhere, in every place, in every time, in every space, and every breath that we take you. You're the only one who satisfies, only one that makes my life make.
I have a
let my love grow cold. I'm calling out, light the fire again. Don't let my vision die. I'm calling out, let the fire again.
One more time.
Don't let cold. I'm calling out, light the fire again. Don't let my vision die. I'm calling out, light the fire again. And I am here to buy gold, refined in the fire, naked and poor. Wretched and blind I come, close me with fire, so I won't be ashamed. Lord, light the fire again. Don't let my I'm calling out, light the fire again. Don't let my vision die. I'm calling out, light the fire again. You know my heart, my deeds. I'm calling out, light the fire again. I need your discipline. I'm calling out, light the fire again. I'm here to buy gold, refined in the fire. Naked and poor, wretched, blind I come. Clothe me with fire, so I won't be ashamed. Lord, light the fire again. I'm here to buy gold, refined in the fire. Naked and poor, wretched and blind I come. Clothe me in white, so I won't be ashamed. Lord, light the fire again. Lord, light the fire again. And Lord, light the fire again.
Thank you, brother. So in a couple minutes, when I dismiss you, I'll see if we can get that music back up. We will or we won't. But what I want to send you home with, because remember, Jesus has the keys. He has all authority. He is the King of Kings, and he is the Lord of Lords. Yes. Yes. And he isn't a baby in a manger anymore. Amen. And he's coming back to rule and to reign. And he's only waiting for one thing. He wants to rule and reign in your heart first. And he keeps putting off his return, because he's going to have to punish those who have not chosen him as king, and he's not in a rush to do that. So let me encourage you this coming year, pray for two things: that he'll rule and reign in your heart, and that he'll rule and reign in your neighbor's heart, so that he'll come quickly. Please bow your heads for the benediction, and you'll be dismissed. May the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. I'll see you over in room 3 in the bistro. God bless.
The bridge of the song that I sing next says, into all the things that have kept you away, that keep you defeated day after day after day, the heartache that nobody sees, those things that eat at your soul like a cruel disease, he who set the captives free, it is he who holds your keys. death rides blackened clouds across the sky. The Son of Man lays down to die. With every pounding blow upon the nail, thunder rumbles all through hell. And from death's barren womb, the captives cry, who is there to free us should he die? His grave becomes a door he enters in, to face the author of all sin. Defying death and the grave, he takes their keys, and with them every captive frees. And from death's barren womb, the captives cry, arise, for our redemption draweth nigh. The gates of hell I now resist, for the shackles that had torn my wrist lay before me now upon the cross. To sin I am no longer. From death's barren womb, he heard my cry and loosed the chains that bound me to a lie. For he holds the keys. He holds the keys. At long last we are free, for he holds the keys. And to all the things that have kept you away, that keep you defeated day after day after day, the heartache that nobody sees, that eats at your soul like a cruel disease, he it is he who holds your keys. For he holds the keys. He holds the keys. And though we've been at long last, we are free, for he.